Okay. Good morning, everyone.
Good evening.
Sorry.
Bonsoir.
Yeah.
Bonjour.
Good evening. You know, Jesus is the sun in my life, so I can say good morning. I really appreciate what we have done. Yesterday concerning the Elf Expo, and I want to encourage some of us who are not interested in the health reform to really consider that it is the right arm of our message. And could you just share with me your schedule? I was impressed by a part of, the statement of Ellen G. White, and I invite you to have a look of this statement on the first page of the schedule. And she said, again and again, I have been instructed that the medical missionary work is to bear the same relation to the work of the third angel message that the right arm and hand bear to the body. Under the direction of the divine head, they are to work unitedly in preparing the way for the coming of Christ. The right arm of the body is to be constantly active. It's right?
Yes. True.
That's true? That's wrong.
Body is true.
The right arm of the body of true. That's true.
Amen.
Which word can you put instead of truth for after the body? Christ. Okay. The body of truth. We could say the body of life, because our message must give life. Yeah, right. Okay. I say this because, you know, if we have a message who does not give life, that message will provide death. Okay. I am just doing a foreword here, okay? In Matthew 18, when you consider Matthew 18, Jesus says that if one member of the body offend thee, cut it off. Is it right? So, do you think that Jesus will not cut off a right arm, which often is truth in working for a wrong body? Don't get me wrong, friends. I'm for the right arm. But I'm sure that God wants the right arm be with the right body. Right? Okay. I say this because some non-Trinitarian Seventh-day Adventists started to preach openly a three angels message totally new and different. These people claim that the historical interpretation of this message is non-based on the Bible and the Bible alone. But I cannot agree with that. I cannot agree with them on that point, as well as many others. Tonight, we speak about the first angel's message. Thursday, we speak about the second angel's message, and Sabbath, we speak about the third angel's message. I only have three sessions But we speak also about the fourth angel message. And if this message is something new for you, I pray that this series of study will help you to stand on the platform of the eternal truth, on the platform of the present truth. But if you are a non-theologically modified Seventh-day Adventist for years, I pray that this series of study will help you to stay firm on the platform, on the present truth. And I want to, you know, we use normally to make a call at the end of a sermon. But I want to make a call right now to the youth. Joseph, Gideon, Ashley, Isaac, Joshua, Zach, Graham, Garrett, Griffin, Swanny. What is Swanny? Okay, he's there. I really hope that Jesus will come soon. But if for any reason he does not come soon, as youths, we need to be prepared to take stand for the truth. And as old folks, as adults, we need to be with our young to teach them on the path of the righteousness. Let's have a word of prayer to start our study. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this privilege that you gave us to be here and in order to open your word and to study it. Father, we need of your spirit, the spirit of truth. And we ask you this in the name of Jesus, your dear beloved Son. Amen. Okay, no problem. Thank you very much.
What's your name?
Jean-Christophe. Just let me know when it's good, IT. Okay. Do you believe that Jesus will come soon? Yes. Responding to his disciples concerning his return, Jesus said in Matthew, let's open our Bible in Matthew 34, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 24, sorry. I will make mistakes, something like that. Matthew 24, and let's read from verse 29, and we'll read verse 29 and 30. Matthew chapter 24, verse 29 and 30. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened. Okay. Shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heavens shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and there shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Do you think that this event requires any preparation?
Yes.
Right, writing to the Thessalonians, Paul said in 1 Thessalonians, let's open our Bible in 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians. And Paul said that, but ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that they should overtake you as a theft, a thief. Verse 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 4. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that they should overtake you as a thief. Why did he say that? Verse 2 gives us the answer. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. Friends, do you want to be in the light? Yes. Do you want to be in the light that day should not overtake you as a thief? Yes. As indicated by its name, the aim of the book of Revelation is to reveal Jesus. And interestingly, the chapter 14 of this book gives us another description of the return of Jesus. Let's turn to Revelation chapter 14. And let's have a look to verse 14. Revelation 14, verse 14. And there we read that, and I looked, and behold, a bright cloud, and upon the cloud one sat like unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. When Jesus came the first time on this earth, John the Baptist had to prepare his way. When you compare Matthew 3, verse 1 to 3, and Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. Do you think that will be different when he will come a second time? I don't think so. Because the verse 6 to 12 of the 14th chapter of Revelation tell me that a threefold message has to be heard before his second coming. And this message says, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angel and in the presence of the Lamb, and the smoke of their torments ascend up forever and ever, and there have no rest, day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus. Friends, if you still want to be prepared for that great event, a good understanding of these warnings is necessary. In this first study, we'll consider some prophecies, and especially their times, in order to establish the time of this threefold message. And we'll have a look to the first angel's message. First of all, notice that the third angel presents to the world the condition to meet God in peace. And that condition is the keeping of the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus. And I ask you to keep that in mind, because we'll go back to it in our study. Keep that in your mind, please, because this is a key point to understand. When this angel starts to give his message, moreover, that angel don't give his message with the two previous one, right? He don't do that. But he followed them, as we read in verse 9. And it's the same with the angel who come before the third, the second. He don't give his message with the previous one, the first. But he followed him, according to what we read in verse 8. And when we arrive to the first angel, we have to say that he also gives his message alone, right? I precise this because when he spoke of the first angel, John says that I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven. It is right? I saw another angel, which implied that he saw another angel in the same way. That is, in the midst of heaven. And this other angel is located in Revelation chapter 8. Let's turn with me in Revelation chapter 8 and let's read verse 13 to see this angel to which John was referring himself, was referring. Revelation chapter 8 verse 13, and we read, "And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitant of the earth by reason of the other voice of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound." This angel says, by reason of the other voice of the trumpet, of the three angels which are yet to sound. Right? And this angel announces to the inhabitant of the earth three rules. And so these three woes are connected to the sounding of the last three trumpets. The fifth trumpet, or the first woe, which one begin in Revelation chapter 9, verse 1, refer to the rise and the spread of Mohammedanism, that is, Islam. And on this point, Albert Barnes said that with surprising unanimity, commentators have agreed in regard to this as referring to the empire of the Saracens or to the rise and progress of the religion of the empire of Mohammed. And furthermore, this event occurred on the 27th day of July in the year 1299 of the Christian era, that Ottoman first invaded the territory of Nicodema, according to Gibbon. Now, the Bible tells us that there were to torment the men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads during how many months? In verse 4, 5, and 10 of Revelation 8? 5 months. You can read in verse 4 of Revelation 8, Revelation 8, verse 4, verse 5, and 10. It is spoken of 5 months, okay? And the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended before God out of the... And verse 4, okay? And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green things, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And verse 5 said, and to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. All right? And on verse 10, we read that, and they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. In the Bible, what is the duration of a month?
30 days.
Okay. So a biblical month is 30 days. So 5 months are? Okay, 150 days. And friends, according to Numbers 14, verse 34, and Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6, we know that a prophetic day is equal to a literal year, right? Okay. And this is the two key verse in the Bible to understand the prophetic day, okay? To rightly interpret them, okay? And according to that, we know that 140 prophetic days is equal to 140 literal years. So when you add this period of this duration to July 27 of the year 1299, it brings us to July 27 of the year 1449. Then follows the sounding of the sixth trumpet, or the second woe, according to what we read in Revelation chapter 9, verse 12 and 13, whose duration had to be for an hour and a day, okay, and a month and a year. I repeat that for you, for an hour and a day and a month and a year. And remember, friends, that in Bible prophecy, one prophetic day is given for one literal year. So 1 hour is 15 literal days. One prophetic day is one literal year. One prophetic month is 30 literal years. And one prophetic year is 360 literal years. So when you do the math, you have 391 years and 50 days. And the result in bold is literal time. And when you add this to July 27 of 1449, it brings us to August 11 of the year 1840. 11, the August 11, 1840 is the end of that period of time. And concerning this date, we read that on the 11th August 1840, the Sultan would voluntarily surrender his independence into the hands of the Christian power. And let me just precise you that this Christian power was England, Austria, Prussia, and Russia. Okay? So, into the hand of the Christian power, just as he had 391 years and 15 days before, received it from the hands of the Christian power. Constantine 13, according to Uriah Smith, and we read that in the book of Daniel and Revelation in the version of 1909. So, we are here at the end of the Second War. And now, friends, remember that the angel of Revelation 8, verse 13, says that there were to be three rules, right? Which one were to be connected to the sounding of the fifth, the sixth, and the seventh trumpet, right? Consequently, friends, the sounding of the seventh trumpet of Revelation 11, verse 15, is the announcement of the third woe. And notice that the third woe does not come right after the end of the second, but that the third woe come quickly after the end of the second woe. Let us read that in verse 14 of Revelation 11. And notice that with me. Revelation 11, verse 14. The second war is past, and behold, the third war comes quickly. The Bible does not say just after. Come quickly. Okay. Thus, the sounding of the seventh trumpet has to begin shortly after the 11th of August 1840. And concerning this trumpet, we read in Revelation chapter 10, verse 7. Let's turn with me in Revelation chapter 10, verse 7. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Notice here that it is not written in the day, but in the days, plural, which implies that the sound of the seventh trumpet will last many years. And even though the book of Revelation does not give any instruction concerning the very date of the ending of the third war, it says that the mystery of God has to be finished when the seventh angel shall begin to sound. Now, I have a question for you. What is the mystery of God? To godliness? Okay, let's open our Bible in Romans chapter 16. Romans chapter 16. And let's read verse 25 and 26. Romans chapter 16, verse 25 and 26. And paid attention to my bold statement. When my voice will be bold, okay? We read that, now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began. But now he's made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. I will ask you the same question now. What is the mystery of God? The gospel. The plan of salvation, right, Jimayu? The gospel, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest. This is the mystery of God. And the seventh angel announced the end of that, friends. So, thus, when the seventh angel shall begin to sound, that is, in the early years, okay, of his sounding, the mystery of God, the gospel, the preaching of the gospel, the mystery of God, or in other words, the probation time, friend, will be finished. And I invite you to keep that in your mind, because we'll come back to it at the end of the study. The sanctuary and the service of the Levitical priesthood was a figure of the sanctuary and the service of the priesthood of Christ, according to what we read in Hebrew. I invite you to turn with me now in Hebrew chapter 9. Let us consider together Hebrew chapter 9 and verse 8 and 9. Hebrew, the book of Hebrew chapter 9, verse 8 and 9. Hebrew chapter 9, verse 8 and 9. The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure of the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience. And I invite you also to compare, but at home, with the verse 22 and 24, from verse 22 to 24. Here, we understand that in the figure, Brother Elvis was speaking this afternoon concerning the pattern. Okay, in the figure, brothers and sisters, the service was completed once every year, according to what we read in verse 6 and 7 of the same chapter of Hebrew 9. Let us read to now, verse 6 and 7. Now, when these things were thus ordained, the priest once always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God, but into the second, once the high priest alone, once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. Okay? But in reality, friends, the service has to be completed, as I said, he has to be completed once a time. And the reason why I am talking here of the sanctuary, friends, it's that in Revelation 11, verse 19, under the seventh trumpet, John saw that the temple of God was open in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his covenant. Let us read that together. Revelation 11, verse 19. Revelation 11, verse 19. Okay. I'm myself wrong. Let's go back to Revelation 11, verse 19. I don't know. Okay. Maybe it's time to wake up for some here. Revelation 11, verse 19. And there we read that, and the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament, and there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hails. John does not say that he saw in his temple the ark of his testament. He does not say that, friends. But that there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament. It's right. True. Which implies that believers saw by faith, of course, the opening of the place where is the ark in the heavenly temple. And friends, if you want to be among those who see with the eyes of faith the place where is the ark in the heavenly sanctuary, which is open, you need, friends, to know when and why the high priest of the Levitical priesthood entered into the place where was the ark in the earthly sanctuary. In the second verse of the 16th chapter of Leviticus, I invite you to turn with me in Leviticus chapter 16, and let's read verse 2. Leviticus chapter 16, verse 2. And there we read that, and the Lord said to Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all time into the holy place within the veil before the mercy seat which is upon the ark, that he die not, for I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat. The high priest, Aaron, had to enter where was the ark only, which day? On the 10th day of the 7th month, according to what we read in verse 29. And friends, the children of Israel has to afflict their souls because, let's read in verse 30 of this same chapter, because for on that day shall the priest make what? An atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be cleansed for all your sins before the Lord. And friends, the atonement was also for, and I invite you to read verse 33 The atonement was for, and he shall make an atonement for the holy sanctuary, and he shall make an atonement for the tabernacle of the congregation and for the altar, and he shall make an atonement for the priest and for all the people of the congregation. And you can also have a look to verse 16, but we'll not read it tonight. This work of atonement or cleansing, which was also called reconciling in verse 20, was the last service of the Levitical priesthood. And as for the figure, friends, the reality needs a work of atonement or cleansing, a work whose the beginning will be after the 11th of August 1840. And it interestingly, we have a prophecy concerning the cleansing of the sanctuary in the book of Daniel. Let's turn with me in the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 8, the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 8. Daniel chapter 8, verse 14. And there we read that, "And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed." Friends, a close reading of this chapter shows that no information was given concerning the beginning of this period of time. But when we returned, when he returns to Daniel in the chapter 9, the angel gives him more information concerning that period of time. And I invite you to go with me now in the chapter 9 of the same book, and let's have a look now to the verse 24 and 25. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. Now, therefore, and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, and in trouble and in troublous times. Again, friend, according to Numbers chapter 14 and verse 34 and Ezekiel chapter 5 verse 6, we know that one prophetic day is equal to one literal year. And so the 70 prophetic weeks are 490 literal years. And these 69 prophetic weeks are 483 literal years. Okay? And notice that at the beginning of the verse 24, we read 70 weeks are determined. And in fact, a word, the understanding of determined is it's cut off. Okay? So 70 weeks was cut off upon the people of Israel. And 490 years were allotted to bring the rebellion of the Jewish people to an end. But notice that these years were cut off. Okay? The another way to make it plain, the 2300 prophetic days, that is the 2300 literal years of the eighth chapter, is the only period, friend, is the only period of time related to what we just read in the verse 44 and 45. And moreover, the first 483 years begin with the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem. Okay, so if we know when this commandment was given, we'll be able to have the starting date for both of the 490 years and 2300 years. And history tells us that when this event foretold by the prophecy happened, the decree that we found in the book of Ezra, chapter 7 and verse 13 to 26, was sent out by the Persian kings Artaxerxes in the fall of the year 457 BC. And now, when we had 2300 years to 457 BC, we arrive in the fall of which year? 1844. Moreover, as the earthly sanctuary was cleansed on the 10th day of the 7th month of the Jewish year, then the cleansing of the heavenly sanctuary, was to start from the 10th day of the 7th month of the Jewish year, which brings us to which date? The 22nd of October, 1844. Right, brother. Friends, on that day, on the 22nd of October, 1844, Jesus started the work of atonement or cleansing in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary before the ark, in which there is, among others, the Decalogue, that is, the commandment of God, the one mentioned by the third angel of Revelation 14. So, consequently, this third angel started to give his message from which date? From the 22nd of October, 1844. In the figure, the work of the atonement took on another characteristic. In Leviticus chapter 23, let us turn in Leviticus chapter 23. Leviticus chapter 23. And let's read verse 29 and 30. Leviticus chapter 23, verse 29 and 30. For whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day, he shall be cut off from among his people. And whatsoever soul it be that doeth any work in that same day, the same soul will I destroy from among his people. during the typical day of the atonement, while the high priest was doing the atonement in the most holy place, the children of Israel had to humble their souls before God in order to receive forgiveness for their sins. And friends, the soul who did not do this had to be cut off from among the people. That is, he had to be cut off without mercy from the congregation of the children of Israel. And then, at that same moment, his probation time was ended. It is therefore clear that such a work of atonement was a work of judgment. And as it was a figure of the service of the heavenly sanctuary, the conclusion is that the work of atonement started by Jesus in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary on the 22nd of October 1844 is the work of judgment announced by the first angel of Revelation 14. But let there be clear here that this judgment is not the executive judgment. Indeed, concerning the coming of Jesus in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, the prophet Malachi, let's turn with me now in Malachi. Malachi chapter 3. The prophet Malachi said in chapter 3, and let's read the from verse 1 to 6, Malachi chapter 3. And let's read what the prophet Malachi reported. He said, "Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. But who may abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like a fuller's soap. And he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant unto the Lord, as in the day of old, and as in former years. And I will come near to you to judgment, and I will be a swift witness against the sorcerers and against the adulterers and against false swearers and against those that oppress the hireling in his wages, the widow and the fatherless, and that turn aside the stranger from his right and fear not me, saith the Lord of hosts. For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye son of Jacob are not consumed." Friends, according to these verses, Jesus had to come to his temple on the 22nd of October 1844 to, first of all, purify his people that they may render a perfect obedience to God's law. And secondly, to judge or witness against those who do not obey God's law. And for his part, the prophet Daniel, in the seventh chapter of his book, let us return to Daniel. Daniel chapter 7. And let's read the verse 13 now. Daniel chapter 7, verse 13. And there we read that, I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the cloud of heaven and came to the Ancient of Day, and they brought him near before me. And notice, for which reason the Son of Man, that is, Jesus, notice for this, for which reason the Son of Man came to the Ancient of Day, who is God, his Father. In verse 10, let's read verse 10 now. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousand and thousand ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. According to these verses, friends, when Jesus came to his Father on the 22nd of October 1844, in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, it was to judge according to what was written in the books. And describing the same scene, John in Revelation, let's return to the book of Revelation, chapter 20. John in Revelation, chapter 20, and in verse 12. John adds, and I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. The book of life contained the name of all those who served the Lord faithfully until the end of their lives. And there is also another book, according to the prophet Malachi, in the chapter 3 of his book. Let us return to Malachi. We are doing a Bible study, so we need to turn the page of our Bible. Malachi chapter 3. Let's return to Malachi chapter 3. And let's read verse 16 of Malachi chapter 3. Where we read that, then they that fear the Lord speak often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. The books of remembrance is the record of the faithful words and deeds of those who have their name written in the book of life. And of course, friends, the hidden words and wicked acts are also recorded according to what we read in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 14, Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 and 37, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5. Thus, the judgment work in which Jesus is involved with his Father, seen the 22nd of October 1844, is an investigative judgment for everybody. only for the people of God. Only for God's people, friend. Because in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, we read that, "For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God, and if it first began at us, what shall the hand be of them that obey not the gospel of God?" And among them, only those who had come before God with confession and repentance, and those and whose sins through the blood of Jesus were transferred to the sanctuary will be cleansed and purified. The investigative judgment, my friends, the investigative judgment of the wicked is a distinct and separate work which will take place after, as well as the executive judgment. And since the third angel started to give his message from the 22nd of October 1844, the second must give his message before that date. That makes sense, right? And thus, the first before the second. According to what we read in Ephesians 4 and in other places in the Bible, the work of preaching the gospel was not entrusted to the literal angel of God. And in other place, the word angel, which was translated from the Greek word angelos, means a messenger, especially an angel, by implication, a pastor, angel, messenger, according to Strong's Dictionary, number G32. And in Luke chapter 7, we read that, "And when the messenger, the angelos of John, were departed, he began to speak unto the people concerning John, what want ye out in the wilderness for to see, and reed shaken with the wind? This is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my angelos, messenger, before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee." And you can also consider Luke chapter 9, verse 52, and James chapter 2, verse 25. In this verse, you can check and see that it is also angelos, which is translated by messenger. And friends, in these verses, we see clearly that the Bible refers to the messengers as being angels. Consequently, the angels of Revelation 14, verse 6 to 12, are God's human messenger. And do you know that 2 years before 1840, Josiah Litch, one of the leading ministers preaching the Second Advent, published an exposition of Revelation 9 predicting the fall of the Ottoman Empire. According to his calculation, this power was to be overthrown in AD 1840, sometime in the month of August, and only a few days previous to its accomplishment, he wrote, allowing the first period, 150 years, to have been exactly fulfilled before Dia causes ascended the throne by permission of the Turks, and that the 391 years, 15 days, commenced at the close of the first period. It will end on the 11th of August 1840, when the Ottoman power in Constantinople may be expected to be broken. And this, I believe, will be found to be the case. And she gives the reference. And friends, we saw in the beginning of this study that this event exactly fulfilled the prediction, and that when he became known, multitude were convinced of the correctness of the principles of prophetic interpretation adopted by William Miller and his associated. And a wonderful impetus was given to the Advent movement. Men of learning and position united with Miller, both in preaching and in publishing his view, and from 1840 to 1844, the work rapidly extended. And like Josiah Leach, William Miller learned that a day in symbolic prophecy represents a year, according to Numbers, chapter 14, verse 34, and Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6. He saw that the period of 2300 years, prophetic days, or literal years, would extend far beyond the close of the Jewish dispensation. Hence, it could not refer to the sanctuary of that dispensation. But, friend, in explaining Daniel 8, verse 14, Miller, as has been stated, adopted the generally received view that the earth is the sanctuary. And he believed that the cleansing of the sanctuary represented the purification of the earth by fire at the coming of the Lord. When, therefore, he found that the close of the 2300 days was definitely foretold, he concluded that this revealed the time of the second advent. His error resulted from accepting the popular view as to what constitutes the sanctuary. William Miller and his associates, which were Protestant believers, had also miscalculated the ending of the 2300 prophetic days. They first understood that this period of time had to end in 1843. And then in the spring of 1844, and finally they arrived to the autumn of 1844. But even though they misunderstood the nature of the event and its time, they gave the right message at the right moment. And indeed, as the disciples were mistaken in regard to the kingdom to be set up at the end of the 70 weeks, so Adventists were mistaken in regard to the event to take place at the expiration of the 2300 days. In both cases, there was an acceptance of, or rather an adherence to, popular errors that blended the mind to the truth. Both classes fulfilled the will of God in delivering the message which he desired to be given, and both, through their own misapprehension of their message, suffered disappointment. But I have a question for you. What does all this mean to us who live in 2017?
It's
we can be sure, someone said. The Lord is at the door, right? Amen. Given that from the 22nd of October 1844, the temple of God was opened in heaven as there was seen is in his temple, the ark of his testament, and that the Bible shows us that this event had to occur under the sounding of the seventh trumpet. Friends, we must recognize that the third woe, or the sounding of the seventh trumpet, started on that same date. But there is more. When Jesus will cease his work of mediation, his work of purification, his work of judgment, the probation time or the mystery of God will be finished. And according to Revelation, that must happen in the day of the voice of the seventh angel when he shall begin to sound. Right, sister. That is in the early years of his sounding. And we are at that moment. We live in that period of time, friends. Friends, we are living within that time. And soon, Jesus will cease his solemn work of high priest. At any time, your case may be investigated. Your life, your character, your conduct, and your motive weighed in the balance of the sanctuary. It will be a fearful thing to be pronounced wanting. Friends, if up to now you was living in sin, any kind of sin, because there is no little sin, friends. Or if sin come back in your life, I invite you today to humble your soul and to go with me to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time or need. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for these blessings that you gave unto us, that for these warnings that you send unto us to be prepared for your judgment. And we want to accept Jesus in our lives, to be cleansed, purified, and that our needs may be all what we need may be given by thee through Jesus. And I ask you to be with us, and especially with our young people here, that they may learn to love the only true God and Jesus, Jesus, your only begotten Son, that you gave unto us to the forgiveness of our sins. Thank you so much, Father, for this message and this solemn message that you gave unto us. But it's also a fearful warning, and we must be prepared for that. So I ask you to be with each of every one of us, and thank you so much, dear Father, for all what you have done for us. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.